welcome to Daily Newspaper Analysis, which is presented to you by LawSeeko. Today, we will discuss two articles. The first article is from the Hindu newspaper, which is titled as Saving Biodiversity, Securing Earth's Future. So as we know, today is 5th of June and we celebrate World Environment Day today. So on that note, we have this beautiful article written about saving the biodiversity of the world and how by doing so, we can secure the future of this earth and we as the people of the earth. The second article is from the Indian Express, which is titled as Putting the Victim on Trial. This is another beautifully written article which talks about the further victimization of rape victims and as to whether or not the consideration of victims' past sexual history is a valid ground in the rape trial or not will be discussed in this article. This newspaper analysis is presented to you by me. My name is Sheva Khan. I am a law graduate and had completed my BA LLB law degree from Uttaranchal University in the year 2019. I was the batch gold medalist and I have been a national debater and a public speaker throughout my educational career. Here at LawSeeko, I'm working as a current affairs expert. If you wish to connect with me, you can always find me on my Twitter as well as LinkedIn handles. Both are mentioned in the description. Also, for the news and flash column, you can definitely go and subscribe to our LawSeeko Judiciary Prep channel or LawSeeko CLAT Prep channel, on which now we have an exhaustive separate video for news and flash. So definitely check it out. Let's see, what is the multiple choice question from yesterday's discussion? Which section of the Indian Penal Code defines sedition? Your options are Section 120, Section 126, Section 124A, or Section 144. If you know the answer, you can put it down in the comment section below. Let's see what is the descriptive question for the day. Do you think that rape victims in India are further victimized during the trial? Give reasons for your answer. So let's start a discussion for the first article of the day, which talks about saving biodiversity. So as we had just mentioned, that today is World Environment Day, which is celebrated on June 5th. So on this note, we need to understand the importance of the biodiversity that plays on the earth and why at all should we strive to save and conserve this biodiversity. So if we find an estimate, forests alone may yield services worth more than a trillion rupees per year. So can you imagine that what huge quantity of money this is and what value do the forests have? That in 1 year alone, they can have a value of at least or even more than 1 trillion rupees. And globally, 7% intact forests are lost since 2000. So that is why we need to understand that how alarming the situation is that in just 20 and 21 years, we have lost almost 7% of the intact forest land of the earth. And that is why the forests also are very much important in mitigating the problem of climate change, which every one of us, every individual, all the governments, the international parties, stakeholders, they're all fighting together to mitigate the climate change. And in this, we should note that biodiversity and forests play a very important and crucial role. So we need to have focus on repairing the dysfunctional relationship with nature as it is one of the ways to mitigate the ongoing climate change. As we know that forests are considered to be the lungs of the earth and as in to be particular, the Amazon forest of Brazil are considered to be the lungs of the earth. And by the virtue of the nature of the trees and the forest, they have the capacity to absorb huge amounts of carbon dioxide, which as we know is the largest element for causing the global warming. And that is why if at all we have good forests in our communities or nearby areas, definitely there will be better consumption or there'll be better inhaling or there'll be better taking in or soaking in of the carbon dioxide and thus definitely the global temperatures will fall down. So preserving biodiversity is directly relevant to the social, economic and environmental well-being of our people. Now let's understand that why at all are we taking all the three spheres, social, economic and environmental into this. See, there are a lot of communities, tribal communities, people and a lot of other stakeholders that depend a lot on the forest areas for various kinds of producers, support system, livelihood, etc. And that is why a lot of societies are held intact by the forest only. For example, let's consider various tribal communities of Chhattisgarh, Andaman and Nicobar, and even Madhya Pradesh that totally depend on the nearby forest areas for their livelihoods. That is why their social life is something that is maintained and regulated by the forest that they fall in. That is why they play a very important role in regulating the social norms of these areas and even the entire society at large. For economic, definitely we have already discussed that forests definitely they provide so many kinds of producers, like for example timber, rubber, etc., that are very, very important in the economic development as well. And as we just discussed, that the forest alone can yield up to ₹1 trillion per year. And finally, environmental, of course, we have discussed that forests are the one that can be easily used to absorb excess of carbon dioxide and definitely can help in mitigating the climate change as well. So that is why we need to rethink and reimagine the concept of one health for all living organisms. In this direction, the Indian government and the India as a stakeholder has also taken some steps that have proved to be successful, but definitely a lot can be done in this direction as well. Let's talk about the National Mission on Biodiversity. The National Mission on Biodiversity and Human Well-being, which in short is known as NMBHWB, was approved by Prime Minister's Science, Technology and Innovation Advisory Council, which in short is known as the PM's TIAC, which is Prime Minister, Science, Technology, Innovation Advisory Council, in the year 2018. So the purpose was to strengthen the science of restoring, conserving and sustainably utilizing India's natural heritage, which was embedded in the biodiversity. Also, the aim was also to establish a citizen and policy-oriented biodiversity information system that could be used every now and then for imparting various kinds of data required in this, and also for this imparting important information regarding the biodiversity and forests in the country. It also has focused on enhancing the capacity across all sectors for realization of India's national biodiversity targets, and it will allow India to emerge as leader in demonstrating linkage between conservation of natural assets and well-being. So this will also help in restoring and increasing our natural assets by crores, and will help in meeting commitments under the Convention on Biological Diversity and also the United Nations Sustainable Development Goals, which needs to be achieved by the year 2030. Also, this initiative offers nature-based solutions to environmental problems, wherein more and more organic and environmental or just natural procedures should be used to cure any problems related to the environment, rather than any kind of temporary or any kind of artificial methods for that matter. So that is why we also, as responsible citizens, today on the day of World Environment Day, should at least take the responsibility of our individual actions. We should not litter any kind of waste here and there, because it is not just one wrapper or one bottle that we throw. Just imagine, we are a population, at least in India, of 130 crores. So one wrapper or one bottle is not just one, rather it turns out to be 130 crore of it. And that is why we should take the responsibility as individuals to work at least on our grounds and at our level to make sure that we are not contributing in the deterioration of the environment, but rather doing anything positive to improve it. Because since we have been given and gifted with this world to live into by our ancestors, we definitely owe this as a duty for our coming generations as well. And that is why we need to move, grow and develop in a very sustainable manner. Let's discuss the second article for the day, which talks about putting victim on trial, which rather is a very interesting and alarming article, I must say. So recently, the Goa Sessions Court referred to the survivor's sexual history while acquitting Tejpal. Now, as we know that Tarun Tejpal, who had been a victim, who had been actually, you know, a case was running after him or against him on the case, on the matter of rape, and it had been going for many years now. So now he has been acquitted by the Goa court, Goa Sessions Court, wherein actually the sexual history of the survivor was considered. So that is why this has triggered the question into the minds of many people as to what can be the possible relevance of the sexual history of the survivor, the rape victim as such. So in this case, the Goa bench, which is basically from the Bombay High Court, remarked that the judgment appears to provide a manual on how rape victims should behave. Yes, that actually has been remarked by the Bombay High Court bench, the Goa bench of Bombay High Court, basically. So wherein at one place we talk about providing best of the justice to the victims, specifically to the rape victims, and making sure that they are not victimized further and that every kind of justice that is possible is imparted to them. There are also various norms and thought lines which say that there has to be a manual as to how the rape victims should behave. Now, on this ground, let's understand that what are the various gender-based stereotypes that we get across. So recently also, the studies have shown that stereotypes about rape survivors lead to acquittals and disparate sentencing in rape cases. What happens is that, see, ultimately, whoever is delivering a kind of judgment, definitely on the lines of constitution or various kinds of IPC, CRPC and other law books, they are sought, but ultimately it is one kind of a human who is definitely moving this kind of a judgment. And thus, whatever thought process they have in their mind regarding a rape victim or a rape survivor, that unfortunately shows up even beyond the constitution, or that clearly puts up his ideology over the actual justice that should have been given. And that is why the kind of stereotypes that people have running into their minds many a times lead in the acquittals of the accused, or many a times in disparate sentencing, which means that it is not up to the mark, which means the proportionality is not taken care of. The kind of punishment which should have been given to that accused is not really given in the real sense. Also, we should note that Article 14 and 15 of the Indian Constitution prevent the state from discriminating based on any stereotypes related to the sex or gender. But still, if at all something like this is happening in the courts of law, definitely it is a clear violation of Articles 14 and 15 of the Constitution of India. So the Supreme Court, in the case of Aparna Bharv and others versus State of Madhya Pradesh and another in the year 2021 itself, held that rape myths include stereotyped notions of chastity, resistance to rape, having visible physical injuries, behaving a certain way, or reporting the offense immediately. So we must applaud that these things were counted as myths related to rape. Now, by myths here, we mean that something that is only said but holds no ground or logic. And these are something that are false logic or false statements regarding rape. So in this case, the Supreme Court held that if at all we are stereotyping our any kinds of notions regarding the chastity, that is the loyalty of the person, the resistance to rape, with how much that woman or that person actually resisted to rape, or having any kind of physical injuries over the body, or behaving in a certain way, or even reporting the offense right immediately after the rape has occurred, these are all the myths related to rape, and these should not be considered while we are delivering any kind of judgment against the accused, or just, you know, considering any trial of rape as well. For example, let me give you a very good analogy over here, that when we talk about resistance to rape or physical injuries, so it is not in all the situations that the person who has been raped is in the position to resist. Many a times it could be a chance that that person was intoxicated and did not even know that she was being raped. So in such situation, can we really expect that there would be any, you know, kind of resistance or any kind of hurt that the accused might have gone through? No. And even if you talk about the visible physical injuries on the victim, so here also we need to consider that many a times it is not always a very forceful way of, you know, committing rape as such in physical means as well. Maybe that the person who is being raped is given such kind of a blackmail, or is given such kind of an intimidation that she would be killed, or her family members would be killed, or there is somebody who's just pointing out a gun to her. In such situations, she might not be in a position to physically resist that person, but definitely that does not amount to consent as well. So in these situations, if at all the courts of law are considering these physical characters as considering or important for determining whether or not the rape occurred, definitely hold no proper logic and no any practical sense as well. So if we consider that, what about the past history of that rape victim and the occurrence of the rape? So Section 155 Clause 4 of the Indian Evidence Act allowed a rape accused to show that the rape survivor was of generally immoral character, and therefore argue that she consented, which was deleted in 2003. Now, can you understand the gravity of this law? That how much could it be misused, and how much would it have been misused when it was functional? Let me give you a very good example of this. that since Article 155, Clause 4 of the Evidence Act, now thankfully and fortunately it is deleted since 2003. So since if it is allowing the rape accused to show that the person who he raped was of immoral character, let's consider that in our general sense and as a taboo, we consider that a prostitute is of an immoral character. Of course, not considering the fact that maybe she was pushed into prostitution or she's doing it for her bare survival or anything like that. But just in the worst case scenario, let's consider that a prostitute is of an immoral character. Now, do you think that even if she is a prostitute, she holds no right to have consent? Absolutely no. Even if she's a prostitute, you pay her to have any kind of sexual advances in your favor, still she has the right to consent to do anything with you or not. Now, in such a situation, if you forced yourself onto her, and just because you proved that she was of so-called immoral character, it definitely does not put down the consent which every human has the right to. Now, be it a man or a woman, everybody has the right to consent. And that is why this was a very bizarre law, and it was thankfully deleted in the year 2003. So just proving somebody's immoral character does not give you the right to push yourself onto that person, and thus it is very much important to have consent of the other person. Now on this part, let me also take you to another direction which might come to your mind as to when we talk about the rape under Section 376 of the Indian Penal Code, it only talks about rape being committed on a woman. Now in this situation, we should consider that is it only the women that can be raped, or can't ever a man be raped? So definitely men can be raped, they are being raped, but this is also something I would call as a limited vision of our law, that we are only still in today's date also considering only a woman as a person who can be a victim of rape. And definitely we should move forward to think into this direction that any person, now be it a man, a woman, anybody, be a transgender, bisexual, or any you know, of any sexuality, any person of any, even a third gender as such, has the right to consent and has the right to be protected if that person has been raped. And definitely the scope of, you know, rape, the definition of rape under IPC should also be widened. Though that was not mentioned in the article, but I thought that it is a good opportunity to talk about this and to think about this as well. So let's get back to the discussion. The past sexual history was also introduced in the rape trials by the way of two-finger test. Now, if at all you have gone through the two-finger test, as in, you know, you know about it, so you should know that this is also considered to be one of the most, I would call as inhuman ways of testing as to rape has been committed on that person or not. And even that, if that person was already engaged into any kind of sexual activities or not. Now, how does that hold any kind of ground that before that that rape occurred, if at all that person was into any kind of sexual activity, so she, or even if, you know, in this case, of course, it's a woman, definitely would have consented for doing it. And she being an adult can do it. And she can give consent or do anything that she likes to. But here, considering that she had been into such kind of relationships before and taking it into consideration under the rape trial definitely holds no ground at all. So here, the move to exclude past sexual history was triggered in the case of Mathura rape case, which was Tukaram versus Maharashtra in the year 1979. And then in the case of Punjab versus Gurmeet Singh in the year 1996, the Supreme Court cautioned courts against making observations about rape survivors' character. And thus, in the year 2013, J.S. Verma committee was set up, which said that prior relationship between accused and the victim should be irrelevant. And also it was held in the case of Lily versus Haryana. And thus we should understand and note that rape stereotypes and reliance on past history damage not only the survivors, but also the entire criminal justice system. And that is why we should not be allowing the courts of law to take any kind of past history of at least the survivor into any kind of consideration, because that holds absolutely no relevance as to what had happened to the victim later on. So this was all for the day. We hope it was a good and informative session for you all. If you like this, please give it a thumbs up and subscribe to our channels for such more updates to come daily. Thank you so much.